Good morning, and thank you for joining us today on our online platforms. We welcome you to continue to join us online through our YouTube or Facebook or our online church platform. We're just so happy that you're here to join us here at Napercov. This is where we are striving to know God fully, to love authentically, and to serve courageously. For those of you who are new, please fill out a connection card so that we can contact you and be able to welcome you to our church. For those who have prayer requests, please send them in. There is going to be a link either on our website or one of our platforms that you can click, and it should lead you directly to where you could submit prayer requests. And on these forms, you can click whether you want it to be staff eyes only or if it's for the whole church. But we've been sending weekly prayer requests out through email, and we've been praying for you all during each staff meeting. So please send that in. We are continuing to worship God through our giving. We have a link as well for you to click. So please take this time, pray over whatever you have to offer, and bless our church with and give back to God. And now is the time to do it. This today, after service at 11:45, we are doing a drive-through communion. So please make sure to come by. This is our first time doing it. We'll have a table set up probably around the roundabout near the bottom of that. So please come, bring your car, drive on over, and we'll have a time for a little bit of fellowship and prayer. The youth are having a scavenger hunt today. So it will be a photo scavenger hunt, and we're gonna be in downtown Naperville. You can sign up at napervillecovenant.com/SSF. And that stands for Summer Sunday Funday. So please sign up so that we know which of the youth are coming and that we can split them up in teams. We're gonna have a prize for those who win and take the best pictures with the most points. And you'll find out more details when you're able to come. Again, that's today at 6 p.m. and we're meeting at the library in downtown Naperville. Well, get ready for musical worship. Stretch, shake up, stand up from your couches. But yeah, please get ready for joining us to worship musically. Thank you.
Well, again, good morning and welcome to Naperville Covenant Church. My name is Kayla and this is Chris, and we are glad to be back with you worshiping this Sunday. As Pastor Josiah said, I want to invite you to stand if you'd like. Put your hands together, turn up the volume on your devices, whatever helps you engage in our worship this morning. So let's sing to God together. Oh, majestic is your name in all the earth. We behold the breaking dawn, the light that shines over everyone. We look to you, we long for you. The rising sun, the earth awakes, your hope has come. We look for you, we long for you, oh Lord. Oh, our Lord, oh, our Lord, how majestic is your name. Like waters rise, come flood this place. We reach for you, we cling to you, oh Lord. Oh, our Lord, oh,
Majestic is your name in all the air.
Continue to sing to our Lord, who is our friend. Let's sing this together.
Jesus, what a friend for sinners. Jesus, lover of my soul. Friends may fail me, foes assail me. He, my Savior, makes me whole. Jesus, what a strength in weakness. Let me hide myself in Him. Tempted, tried, and sometimes failing, He my strength, my victory wins.
Our help.
Jesus, what a help in sorrow, while the billows hold me roll. Even when my heart is breaking, He, my comfort, helps my soul.
Continue to sing and worship to our God. He is with us no matter where we are. He is there with us. And He has shown us His love, His great love and mercy. And so therefore He is worthy of all of our praise. He is worthy of our life that we would offer to Him. So let's sing this together.
Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for You. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you. And holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. We sing that he's worthy. Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you, God. And holy, there is no one like. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. And holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up. Show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me.
This is our truth that we sing out together. I will put my trust in you alone, and I will not be shaken. And holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Oh,
good morning. My name is Kelly Johnston, and I have the privilege of leading us in prayer today. So would you join me in prayer? God, we are so grateful to be able to come to you in prayer, And as we just sung, Lord, we put our trust in you. We set our feet on the firm foundation of your love, your unchanging, unrelenting love for each of us and for all of your creation. So, Lord, I pray that you would give us reminders throughout this week as we walk, as we set our feet on the ground, that we would remember that it's not just the ground that we're walking on, that we have a firm foundation in your love. And God, right now there is so much that can unsettle us, that can threaten to crack that foundation and give us pause and worry and wonder how it is that we can trust in you. But God, we pray that our feet would stand firmly and steadfast, trusting in you. Lord, we trust in you for our world. We trust in you for our country. We trust in you for our community and for our church. God, you know the needs across this globe and across this country. Lord, we are concerned about the coronavirus as it is gaining and growing in many places around the United States. God, we call out to you that you would use all the resources at your disposal to bring an end to this virus. We pray for people to make wise choices, safe choices, to prevent the spread of this disease. And God, we pray for those who are sick, those who are compromised. Would you be with them, bring healing and strength, Lord? We pray for all the health professionals who care for those. We pray for the scientists who are working hard to find vaccines and medications to help. God, we just cry out to you that you would work in a mighty way through this time. And even as we wait for you to do your work to bring healing and restoration of this virus, God, we look to you to do your work in our hearts, that not only would we be healthy physically, that's our hope, but that we would have healthy hearts that look to you, that trust in you. And as we face hard questions and hard decisions, Lord, that you would be the one who guides us and directs us, and that maybe in this time you would strip away some of the distractions so that we can trust in you. God, we pray that for our church as well, that you would unite us and connect us even as we are still apart. We thank you for the opportunity today to drive through communion, to see each other. We just pray that that would be a really beautiful time of connection to you and to your people. Lord, we pray for the different ministries that are happening right now in different and creative ways, for our kids who are doing VBS, for our youth who are gathering in outdoor settings and with safety precautions. Lord, we just pray that you would bless these connections and these ministries, and that we would know, love, and serve through all these different things that we are doing. God, of course, we come to you just trusting you for the needs of the individual members of our congregations, for people that we know and love, and just those who are in need of your care and your provision today. God, we think of those who are struggling health-wise. We think especially of Marilyn Swanson, Kathy Bittner's mom. We pray, Lord, that you would bring healing and peace to her right now as she's been in the hospital. We pray for Jean Elwine. Thank you that she is improving and now is transferred to a rehab facility. We pray, Lord, that as she gets settled there, as she does the work of healing there, Lord, that you would be there with her. We pray that you'd protect her and protect that facility against any virus coming in and spreading. We just pray that you would bless Jean as she interacts with people there. She's such a light, and we pray that you would shine your light through her. God, we pray for those who mourn today, and we have such heavy hearts thinking of two of our brothers and sisters in our church family who have lost close loved ones. We lift up Lincoln Lockhart and his family to you as they grieve the passing of his brother Richard. We pray that you would bring your peace and your love and even times of joy as they remember his life, Lord. Pray that you would bless them in a special way as they grieve and mourn. we pray for Barb Dwyer, who lost her father this past week. And we think of their family as they've been up to Michigan, and we just pray, Lord, that the same thing, Lord, that you would bring peace, that you would surround them with your love, that they would sense that you are caring for them and drawing them together even as they feel this huge loss. And Lord, we know there are others who've lost loved ones even just in the past few months, and those who've maybe lost ones even a long time ago, and yet the sadness is still there. We pray, Lord, that you would come with your care and compassion and minister to those who grieve and mourn. God, we pray for our community. I think especially today I want to pray for the parents in our community, many of whom are facing difficult choices or about to start living with difficult choices that they've had to make about schooling for their kids. And we just pray for the administrators, the teachers, all the staff that will be entering into a whole new reality this coming school year. We pray that for the many details that still need to be sorted out and communicated and put into action. God, we just pray for a spirit of cooperation. We pray for safety and protection. We pray that the kids who will be re-entering classrooms, that they would feel just an inspiration, even though things are so different, that you would just move in them to help them to adjust and adapt. And for the kids who will be learning in other different ways at home, or maybe even trying out homeschool for the first time, their families, we pray for them as well, Lord, that you would use this time to create new connections, new pathways to learning. And that somehow, God, through all of this craziness, that you would work through it, and that you would draw people to yourself, that your people would point the way towards you as that firm foundation that we have. So, God, we love you. We thank you that you hear us when we call, and may we follow after you as you call to us. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
I'm Robbie Hursthouse, and I will be reading Matthew 18, 21 through 35. Then Peter came to Jesus and asked, "Lord, how many times shall I forgive my brother or sister who sins against me? Up to seven times?" Jesus answered, "I tell you, not seven times, but 77 times. Therefore, the kingdom of heaven is like a king who wanted to settle accounts with his servants. As he began the settlement, a man who owed him 10,000 bags of gold was brought to him. Since he was not able to pay, the master ordered that he and his wife and his children and all that they had be sold to repay the debt. At this, the servant fell on his knees before him. 'Be patient with me,' he begged, 'and I will pay back everything.' The servant's master took pity on him, canceled the debt, and let him go. But when the servant went out, he found one of his fellow servants who owed him 100 silver coins. He grabbed him and began to choke him. 'Pay back what you owe me,' he demanded. His fellow servant fell to his knees and begged him, 'Be patient with me. I will pay it back.' But he refused. Instead, he went off and had the man thrown into prison until he could pay the debt. When the other servants saw what had happened, they were outraged and went and told their master everything that had happened. Then the master called the servant in. 'You wicked servant,' he said. 'I canceled all that debt of yours because you begged me to. Shouldn't you have had mercy on your fellow servant just as I had on you?' In anger, his master handed him over to the jailers to be tortured until he should pay back all he owed. This is how my heavenly Father will treat each of you unless you forgive your brother or sister from your heart." The word of the Lord.
Hey, thank you once again for joining us in worship this morning. I'm so excited to spend some time in God's Word today. So join me in a word of prayer. Gracious and Holy Father, as we continue to worship you through the preached word, dear Lord, we pray that what is presented to you this morning brings you glory and that you find your servant faithful. Dear God, we pray that our hearts and our minds are transformed through the music, through the word, through prayer, dear Lord, so that we each day look more and more like you as we talk about this concept of love that translates to mercy. So for that, God, we just ask you to be with us. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. So as the text, Matthew chapter 18, verses 21 through 35 have already been read, I want to lift up a title to you, A Love That Shows Mercy. A Love That Shows Mercy will be the title that kind of shapes our morning together. Over the past couple of weeks, we have talked about this concept of doing justice, loving mercy, and walking humbly with God. And part of the reason that we began to kind of dive into 1 Corinthians chapter 13 is because it was the understanding that we gathered that part of our ability to live into that call as the church was that we needed to understand what it really meant to love and what it meant to love each other through a biblical lens. You know, what did the Bible have to say about love? Because the reality, brothers and sisters, is that all of the things that we are called to do as a church, again, if love is not the undergirding foundational factor, then we are inept. We are unable to live those things out correctly and successfully. So as it pertains to doing justice and now today as we talk about mercy, we are constantly reminded that love has to be the motivation for us being able to show mercy. This morning as we dive into this text of Matthew chapter 18, we see that this is one of the longer discourses that we see from Jesus. We know thematically that at this point, Jesus is getting or nearing the end of his ministry. And so at this point, the opposition that he has faced is at an all-time high. It is at a groundswell. The church, the synagogue leaders, the religious leaders of the time are upset with him. They are aggravated with him. And so the opposition is strong. But Jesus also knows that the conclusion of his ministry is upon them. He knows that it is coming to an end, and he knows that he must do everything that he can to prepare his disciples for his absence when he physically will no longer be with them. And so he is taking particular time to teach them these different concepts in order to help make sure that they are prepared for when he's not around. This particular discourse is continuing to flesh out the different principles that should define the community of believers, should define a community of faith. If we put those in today's world or words, in other words, what we are seeing laid out in Matthew chapter 18 is really shaping and defining how the church should relate to each other in the world around it. As we continue to think through what it means to be the church and live into being the church and live through our call. And so Jesus is taking this opportunity to teach. And to sum it up nicely with a bow, what we realize in this particular text, after we have just seen what Jesus has to say about how we deal with brothers and sisters who are unrepentant in their sin, he goes on to remind us at the end of chapter 18 that the purpose or the most important parts of discipline is to usher folks into a place of restoration. In other words, when we are disciplining folks, when we are holding people accountable, it's not to the end of dispelling, as opposed to the hope is that the forgiveness, that the mercy being shown, that the discipline that is happening really calls people back into right relationship with God and the body. And so for those who are sincerely repenting, there is a place for them. The interesting part about this is we see in verse 21 that Jesus is continuing to raise the bar. In verse 21, it says, then Peter came to Jesus and asked, he said, Lord, how many times shall I forgive my brother or sister who sins against me? Up to seven times? He asked. Jesus responds, he said, I tell you, not seven times, but 77 times. The first thing that we see is that there's a continual raising of the bar. There's a continuing upping of the ante. The standards are continuing to be raised. They aren't being lowered. They aren't being drawn back. But what Jesus is saying to his disciples is that we have to be better, do better, and to raise the bar over what the religious leaders of that time had been doing. And brothers and sisters, I believe that is something that we need to do today. Old Testament studies will tell you that that three times forgiving somebody for sinning against you three times was the standard, and that at the fourth time the person could be not forgiven, that you have fulfilled your duty to any given person by forgiving them three times. I think that Peter thought that maybe he was doing something awesome when he suggested to Jesus, because he knew that Jesus would understand what the Old Testament thought process was. In a time where they were no longer requiring blood sacrifices. And so he comes to Jesus and he says, hey, seven times should I forgive a person who sins against me seven times? Because Peter now has doubled plus what is normally expected. He probably thought that he was doing something great. And then Jesus says to him, I tell you, not seven times, but 77 times. We see that Jesus continues again to raise the bar. You have heard it said, as he said earlier, an eye for an eye. But he says that if someone strikes you, you turn to them the other cheek. We are called and challenged to go the extra mile. Jesus is saying that we just can't settle for what's good enough, but we must strive to be better and better and better and better. So once again, he has raised the bar. Brothers and sisters, part of the call of the church is that we have to live to a higher standard. We can't accept well enough. We can't accept just being good, but we must constantly strive to set ourselves to the bar that Jesus has set. Brothers and sisters, but part of what makes that so hard for many of us is because oftentimes we compare down instead of comparing up. I'm going to say that again. We compare down instead of comparing up. Well, what do I mean by that? It's easy for us to feel good about who we are and what we're doing when we compare ourselves to people that seems to be doing worse than what we are. We allow ourselves, we give ourselves some sense of moral high ground because we're able to say, hey, I know I'm not perfect, but at least I'm not doing that. But brothers and sisters, we are called to not compare ourselves to other fallen sinners because we all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. We are to compare ourselves to the Son of God, to whom there was no flaw, to whom there was no error. And when we compare up, then we are constantly reminded that we will always be in the need of mercy, and we can't allow ourselves to be so self-righteous that we don't recognize that even our best selves and our best days, our best dressed moments, that we still need the grace of God. It kind of reminds me of here recently, I went to the dentist and I needed to get a crown. And in the process of getting the crown, what I didn't know is they have these porcelain images of teeth that they compare to your tooth to make sure they get the right color so that their one tooth is not standing out against the other. Now, brothers and sisters, I was pretty sure that my teeth were pearly white until the dentist brought out this palette with varying colors. And when I saw the particular tooth that represented the brightest, whitest tooth, and I saw the one that actually matched my teeth, I was reminded that it's easy to think that everything is right and perfect when you're comparing it to nothing, or you're comparing it to something worse. But when we begin to look up, when we begin to compare up, we are constantly reminded that there is a standard that we are called to, that we must work to get to every single day. And that we can only do that with the help of Jesus. And so this text starts out with this reminder that we cannot settle for less, that we cannot settle for being subpar, that we have to constantly strive to reach the standard, because Jesus has raised the standard. He has upped the ante, and we are called to try to attain it for the sake of the kingdom. When we get to verse 23, it goes on to say this. Jesus begins to tell this parable after he says to them, I tell you, not seven times, but 77 times. He goes on to say, therefore, the kingdom of heaven is like a king who wanted to settle accounts with his servants. And as he began the settlement, a man who owed him 10,000 bags of gold was brought to him. Since he was not able to pay, the master ordered that he and his wife and children and all that he had be sold to repay the debt. At this, the servant fell on his knees before him. Be patient with me, he begged, and I will pay back everything. The servant's master took pity on him, canceled the debt, and let him go. Brothers and sisters, the next thought that I am reminded of in this text is this. We owe a debt to the master that we cannot pay. It is believed that this 10 bags of this 10,000 bags of gold that was owed to the master by this particular servant will be the equivalent to $2.5 billion today. $2.5 billion. This servant was indebted to the master. And when it came time to settle accounts, when it came time to pay the piper, as they would say, this servant fell short. And he fell short in such a way that he deserved whatever punishment was coming. And at the time, the appropriate punishment would be to sell he and his family into slavery and servitude in order to pay back the debt. But the reality, brothers and sisters, was that this servant, there wasn't enough time in the world to pay back the debt that was owed. I don't know about you, but this kind of reminds me of us, brothers and sisters, that we owe a debt to our master, to God, that we cannot pay. The brothers and sisters, reality is like the scripture tells us, that we have all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, that we are all born into sin. We have been sinning since the beginning of time. But somehow our God loved us so much that he saw fit to send down his son, Jesus Christ, to pay our debts. And so, brothers and sisters, we have this gift of salvation. Our debt has been paid. Our debt has been canceled. God has forgiven us our sins. He has washed us clean. He has washed us white as snow. Well, we have this free gift of salvation that we cannot buy, we cannot earn. But it doesn't mean that God doesn't expect something from us. That there is no way that we can repay the debt that we owe. But as a thanks offering, as a gift of praise, as a life transformed by a sacrifice so big, God expects us to live a life that is reflective of a transformed and changed heart. We see that this servant got on his knees and he begged and he pleaded. He said, be patient with me, I will pay you everything back, even though it was impossible for that debt to be paid. It didn't say that the master reduced the debt. It didn't say that he put him on an income-based repayment program. It said that he canceled the debt and let him go. Gave him an opportunity to live a new life that was debt-free. Brothers and sisters, I think that one of the most thankful or the most God-honoring things that we can do as we have been given this new life in Christ is to live lives that are reflective of the magnitude of the sacrifice that he has for us, that he has given for us. What does that look like to you? What does it look like to be transformed as you consider the way that you went about life before you had that life transforming moment with Jesus Christ? Has anything changed about the way that you walk? Has anything changed about the way that you talk? Has anything changed about the way that you love and the way that you engage the world and the community around you? But most importantly, has anything changed about the way that you show mercy? Because again, brothers and sisters, oftentimes we allow ourselves in the midst of our growth and in the midst of our maturation to forget where we came from, to forget that we were once wretched sinners. We are in church so long, we've been in service for so long, we've been deacons and elders and ushers and things so long that we forget what it was like. And allow that moment of forgetting to allow us to judge those. And one of the places that it shows up is in our inability to show mercy to those who need it most. Because we often forget that we are constantly in need of mercy as well. It's funny, as the text goes on, after his debt is forgiven and he is let go and he has been forgiven of all of his debt and he has this new pass on life, this very same servant, brothers and sisters, found a fellow servant, a fellow brother, who owed him 100 silver coins. And we know, just even between the difference in silver and gold, that what he was owed paled in comparison to what it was that he owed the master. It says, but when that servant went out, he found one of his fellow servants who owed him 100 silver coins. He grabbed him and began to choke him. Pay back what you owe me, he demanded. His fellow servant fell to his knees and begged him, be patient with me and I will pay you back. But he refused. Instead, he went off and had the man thrown into prison until he could pay the debt. When the other servants saw what happened, they were outraged and went and told their master everything that had happened. Then the master called the servant in. You wicked servant, he said, I canceled all that debt of yours because you begged me. Shouldn't you have had mercy on your fellow servants just as I had on you? Brothers and sisters, what this lets me know is that we should show mercy as a response to the mercy that has been shown to us. That we are called as believers to be merciful because God has shown us mercy. You know, the golden rule falls short because we will often say, do unto others as you would have them do unto you. But I believe that is not far enough. I believe that maybe we should reshape it and reform it and say, do unto others as we would have God do unto us. Because in our weakest moments, in our moments of despair, we are constantly asking God to forgive us over and over and over. We are constantly asking God to help change us and sharpen us and make us better. Because we often fall, like the old gospel singer Donnie McClurkin said, we fall down, but we get up. Brothers and sisters, the Christian life and the Christian journey is one that is filled with mistakes. But God gives us another chance and another chance and another chance and another chance. And the best thing that we can do to show how thankful we are to God for the mercy and forgiveness that he has shown us is to be merciful to those who wrong us and who mess up. The biggest example of a transformed heart is living a transformed life that gives other people the mercy and the space that they need to be transformed. Brothers and sisters, if we compare the sacrifices that we are called to make to the sacrifice that Jesus made, we will always be reminded that what we sacrifice can never match up. Because even though as brothers and sisters in Christ, we are called to bear a cross daily, we've never been asked to be nailed to the cross. And so even in my most self-righteous moment, I have to be reminded that even though I may be sacrificing and this sacrifice is costing me something, it will never cost me crucifixion. When we compare how we've been offended, when people have sinned against us, when people have wronged us, it'll never compare to how offensive our sin is to God. Yet God, our Creator, loved us so much, he sent his Son, Jesus Christ, to die for us. Because his love for us was so strong that no offense could carry us away from him, could separate us from him. And so he sends his Son Jesus as a sacrifice to pay all of our debts, my debts, your debts, the debts past, present, and future. He pays the debt for humanity, one that humanity could not bear the weight of. He shows us a mercy through action that gives us all the opportunity to live free of the debt of sin that we owe, and gives us the opportunity and life and freedom in Christ. But that freedom that we have accepted binds us to the work of the cross, which means that we are called to forgive and show mercy the same way. We are called to show mercy to those who don't even deserve it, or those who don't even fully appreciate it. I've heard mercy described like this. Mercy is not giving somebody something that they deserve. In our most hurt and offended moments, we may be justified in some of the ways that we want to respond. But our God is calling us to show mercy, even though people's decisions and lives can sometimes call for a certain response. We are called to respond in love and mercy and forgiveness. Because the mercy that we show, the forgiveness that we show, could be the moment that a person's life is transformed. That through the mercy that we extend, that people have an opportunity to see a tangible picture of the love that Jesus Christ has for them, dear Lord. And we are obligated to present people opportunities to respond to the love of Jesus Christ. So when we think about doing justice, and we've talked about that for the past couple of weeks, when I think about loving mercy, we are called to be invigorated by mercifulness. So even in those moments where we are justified in our anger and justified in our response, we are called to raise the bar. We are called to forgive. We are called to show mercy, even if by human standards, people don't deserve it. Because brothers and sisters, we didn't deserve the sacrifice that was made for us. We didn't earn it. We couldn't do anything like the rich young ruler who said, "What must I do to be saved?" The reality, brothers and sisters, there's no thing that we do other than accepting the free gift that was given to us. And we are called to extend. Is your life, is your expression of Jesus Christ one that's full of mercy? Let's pray. Gracious God, we know that we often fall short. We know that it's easy to find a moral high ground, dear Lord, when we decide we are better. But dear Lord, but in those moments when we find ourselves being self-righteous, when we find ourselves being holier than thou, dear Lord, remind us that when we compare ourselves to your Son, Jesus Christ, there will always be work to do. Keep our hearts and our minds humble. Let our lives be lives that are marked with mercy. Let the mercy that we show be the thing that the world needs to feel your presence. In your Son, Jesus' name, we pray. Amen.
Stronger than darkness, new and
His mercy is more.
Receive now this benediction. God, we are reminded that your mercies are new every day, that there is no limit to your forgiveness, and we are thankful for that. So as we prepare to go about our days, Lord, we simply ask that the God of mercy and the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit rest, rule, and abide between each of us until we gather again. Go in peace. Serve the Lord. Show mercy. Amen.